All right, after two terms in the U.S. Senate, Roy Blunt, senior senator of Missouri, announced he will not be running for the position in 2022. We'll take a look at how he has been a model of conservatism over the past 12 years in the U.S. Senate and prior to that in the House of Representatives. And my question is, why and what's next? Joining us now is Senator Roy Blunt. Senator, welcome back to the program.
Tony, great to be with you. Thanks for your friendship and the friendship we're going to continue to have moving forward, both in the rest of this year and next year in the Senate, and I'm sure after that. You're a great friend, great advisor. I think you showed the video we put out the other day from in front of the dairy barn on our family farm at Stratford. I learned a lot at that dairy barn and on that farm. And I hope the lessons I learned, both of getting the work done and the importance of finding a solution, but also the importance of standing up for the things that you are here to advance and stopping the things you're here to stop, have also been part of my work in the Congress and my work with you. As you pointed out, at the end of this term in the Congress, I will have been in the Congress for 26 years and sometime in elected office in Missouri before that. And I think this is going to be, frankly, a particularly good year for Republicans, which makes it a good year to make way for somebody else to come and start their career in the Congress, whether it turns out to be 26 years or 6 years or what whatever they're going to add to the Senate. But you and I are both going to be concerned, I know, about who follows me in this Senate seat. And I think this is going to be a great year for Republicans. I think it would have been a great year for me to run in Missouri, but more importantly, I think it's a great year to take the opportunity to create a chance for somebody to be here who can be here for a long time.
Well, I want to go back for a moment to that farm and the lessons learned on the farm. You know, one thing, having grown up in the country myself, you know when to wear the boots based on what part of the farm you're walking in. And there's a need for that in Washington. But you've been able to navigate the terrain pretty well. You're a whip in the House. That's when we first met. You were deputy whip, or I think deputy whip before when we first met, and then whip. But in the Senate, of course, I campaigned with you there in Missouri when you ran for the Senate as well. There's some might say there's a trend here. You're not the only Republican that's not running in 2022. Is there something more behind this, or is it just, you know, it's time to move on for something else?
Well, I don't know if there's, I can't speak for anybody else. I do know that at least three of the four or five people leaving came when I did 10 years ago. 12 years is a long time. Pat Toomey, Rob Portman, and I all had service in the Senate and before that in the House. And so nobody is dropping in and then quickly dropping out, but coming to do a job. And I'm pleased with what we've been able to get done. You know, you and I working together, particularly in the critically important funding committee on the health issues and education issues and labor issues, have spent a lot of time together. Other people will step up. I think this is going to be a great year for Republicans. I think it's likely that we take over one and maybe both of the houses of the legislature. I think the Democrats are overreaching in a dramatic way, even more than they did in 2009. But I can see that 2010 opportunity coming again in 2022. And I think that makes it maybe a good decision for everybody who's been here for a decade and soon 12 years to think, is this the time I want to stay for another term, or is it time to do my best to see that I'm replaced by somebody who largely agrees with me on the issues and can carry this forward even further?
Well, that's certainly a good way to look at it, because I do think you're right. If you look, and this is where historical perspective is important, when you go back to 2009 and the overreach with Obamacare and the fact that they had a much bigger margin in 2009 going into 2010 elections, and that evaporated because of the overreach there. They don't have much to work with in the House this time around. I think you're right. I think the momentum is going to be on behalf of conservative candidates that are running. And so this would be a good time. I commend you. I think it would be a good time for a handoff. Certainly, you wouldn't have difficulty in a re-election. But let me ask you this. What's next for Roy Blunt?
Well, I don't know. You know, I've never really had a very well thought out plan, and it's worked for me pretty well so far. I'm very focused on these next 2 years. I think whatever develops next will develop. I think I'm going to be leaving at a time when I still have an opportunity to do other work, and not just that work growing up on the farm, but also I think I haven't had somewhere to go to work. I haven't not had anywhere to go work every day since I was 17. So the idea of just retiring is not particularly appealing to me, but the idea of having an opportunity to take what I've learned in this years of public service, both to our state and to our country, and to have another chance to do something different with that is appealing. Maybe I'll become your co-host on many of these programs, and you and I'd enjoy doing that.
I'll pull up another chair. We can do that. You know, one of the things, it's a privilege. I've served in public office, not nearly as long as you have, and not in the United States Senate, but I've served at the state level. And it's a true honor, and it's a privilege to serve and represent the people. But it's also very demanding. And especially right now, I think you could attest to this. I've certainly seen it in my almost 20 years in Washington now, of how acrimonious the process has become and how politically polarized the nation really is. And it's a lot different than it was 20 years ago. There really is no middle ground anymore.
Well, there's no doubt democracy truly is never particularly easy. I think it has gotten more challenging, but the opportunities I've had to work for Missourians for four decades now, truly extraordinary based on anything I would have imagine possible whenever I was growing up. And, you know, I'm looking at this really in gratitude and optimism. I do think the decisions we make right now are really important. And frankly, I know you talked about H.R. 1, this number one House bill. Their number one priority is to change the political rules in the country in a way that make it hard for conservatives and hard for Republicans to compete. And they've been trying to do all of these things in one form or another for at least 25 years now. They believe they've got that moment to change the rules, to put themselves in a greater place of power. You know, you just pointed out the difference in where we are now in 2010. 2010, there were 40 Republicans in the Senate that had been, that's where we found ourselves at the beginning of the Obama administration. It didn't take long before we were back in the majority. This time we're as close as we could possibly be in the Senate. And the Democrats lost House seats. They lost legislative seats around the country. They're acting as if they have a mandate that's clearly not there. And that's gonna cause them real problems, I think, on Election Day. The country does focus on getting information maybe from only the source that they're most comfortable with. And so one thing I've seen really is people coming to discussions in our office, telephone call conversations, where they have their own distinctive set of facts. And part of the job of being in the Senate or in the Congress or in public office is trying to do your best to assemble all the facts, make your decision based on them, and then explain to people who wonder why you made that decision, why the facts you were able to put together maybe slightly vary from what they thought were what you were looking at. You know, I mentioned the other day, I voted almost 12,000 times in the House and Senate. I'm sure all those votes weren't exactly right, but they were right based on what I knew at the time and what I could do to put all the information together you could put together at the time. One of the easiest things to do is to criticize somebody in public office. And if we've got a national sport, that's probably it. And when you sign up for these jobs, you sign up for that. But the opportunity to be in this great debate in the greatest country in the world is so important. I hope people don't lose faith in the system. Democracy is just not easy. And with all the new sources of information, that may have made it a little harder in the short run, but I hope we begin to move toward assembling more of what is out there to put together before people rush to judgments and decide that you didn't know enough about what you're doing, when in fact you may have been able to put more things together than they had been able to put together before. You do your job for them, which is to use your best judgment, stick with your values, move forward as we hope the country moves forward in the right directions.
Well, and you've done it well, Senator Blunt. Look forward to working with you over the remainder of these next 2 years. But thank you for your service, and thanks for your friendship, and thanks for joining us today.
Tony, great to be with you. I look forward to talking soon.
All right, folks, stick with us. On the other side of the break, we'll be joined by Florida Congressman Waltz. We'll be talking about foreign policy issues, China clamping down on the autonomy of Hong Kong, and the Iran deal. That's next. Don't go away. We'll